Sheltered. Chapter 22. Serendipity. They clambered up the slope through the fallen leaves to the banks of the stream. Brandon went first, reaching his hand down to Katie to pull her over a tricky rocky outcrop. Age followed, using a sturdy cut-down branch as a tool for levering himself up the slope behind him. When they reached the top of the hill, they reached the creek. At one side, a waterfall sending water cascading toward the way they came. The other side was mostly slow and placid, with half-submerged rock stepping stones highlighting their way over. It didn't look particularly safe to Katie, but she gingerly followed Brandon over, nearly tripping into the water at one point, until Age caught her fall. After crossing the creek, they followed its north bank along to the east, still going uphill. Katie had never done cross-country walking like this since she was a kid, and her skinny calf muscles ached tremendously by the time they were halfway up the hill. A mile more, and she started groaning at the boys.
"Guys, I have to stop," she gasped, rasping for air. "I can't make it much further,"
she added pathetically, like someone on a trek through the Vietnam War. Brandon showed no signs of fatigue whatsoever.
"Go on then, slow coach," he mocked.
She stopped and sat on a clean, chopped tree trunk. Age leaned on a tree and wiped a dab of sweat off his head, smiling.
"I figured all those gym outings were for a reason," he said. "Still, can't beat the real thing, huh?"
Brandon exhaled briefly, showing only the most minor signs of exertion, and walked back to join them.
"You guys are so unfit," he laughed, amused at them.
"What's the point of that barbecue protein if you're not going to use it for something?" Age chuckled.
"Whoa there, Superman."
Katie coughed and spat out the surplus of saliva she'd got from her overheating body.
"Could we not do something less strenuous now?" she complained.
"That's hardly the fighting attitude," Brandon laughed, and took her hand to pull her upright again. "Come on, not long to the top."
"No, no, no,"
Katie moaned as he dragged her limp arm behind him like a pup on a leash. Age's mouth twisted to a smile, and he snuck up behind her and tickled her sides.
"Ah!"
She jumped and ran along in front of Brandon, giggling.
"Eh? Oh hey, you found a way to motivate her," he said, narrowing his eyes.
"I'm not going all the way up the top of that hill. You're going to have to drag me there,"
Katie said, putting on a silly voice as she strode backwards through the woods ahead of them.
"You'll be there before you know it," Age soothed.
"Me, on the other hand."
"Oh, you see, Age wants to go back too. Can we all go back? It's downhill that way."
"Well, Age can. I gotta write that letter to see before it starts getting too dark to see by."
He motioned to the sky. "It's kind of shit using little torches to write by."
"Can't we just go back now?" Katie pleaded. "You can tell me about the thing we were gonna see. I like stories. Or draw it."
Brandon shook his head and Katie pouted, collapsing back on a nearby tree.
"All right, Age. See you later, lover boy."
"Gay. Have fun,"
Age called as he mock saluted with his water bottle and strolled back. Katie put on a performance of resentment as she gazed at him from her slack reclined position against the tree. Brandon made his hands into claws and ran up to her with a pincing motion aimed at her waist again. She laughed with a yelp and jogged up the hill fast a few meters, but her efforts to outrun him in bursts were weak at best, and he finally brought his cold fingers to her sides. She giggled helplessly as she slowed down her run, her elbows reactively pressed close beside her ribs as she laughed uncontrollably, Brandon's hands tickling her waist until she collapsed to her knees on the ground below him. He let her go and she breathed an elated sigh of relief.
"You're such a bastard,"
she said, not really meaning it, as her grin betrayed. She rolled onto her back in the autumn leaves like a cat and sprawled out, Brandon once again towering above her, looking around the forest.
"Well, if you're up to it, yet," We should reach the top if we keep going northeast in about 20 minutes. She wrinkled up her nose sweetly.
Yuck, more tabbing. And what if I'm not up for it?
The answer was inevitable as he briskly ducked down onto one knee and tickled her again.
No, wait, ahaha!
She burst out again, bucking away from his hands in hysteria. He finally let go after what seemed like a minute, and she breathed, exhaustedly, with an embarrassed smile on her face. That's what, he said, and he reached down to kiss her softly. Her arms went limp as a wave of both surprise and relaxation hit her. He kissed her deep. It was a lasting kiss. And when he broke it off and began drawing his head away, she reflexively tried to reach her lips up for more, but he was out of reach, kneeling high above her. You coming? He said, gripping her hand again, preparing to tug her to her feet.
Yes,
she said, without thinking about the walk ahead of her any more. The trek up the steep part of the hill felt even worse on her legs as she followed Brandon up more of the soily, stony, and leaf-covered slopes. But whenever her foot slipped back, he always heard it and reached a hand back for her to grab. Katie's leg muscles stung at the pain she had put them through. She was so out of breath, and the air she was drawing into her lungs felt cold, like it was freezing the inside of her chest up. And then at last they reached the top, and Katie could see what all the fuss was about. The view over the trees was dominated by a blue dividing line. The sea. She could hardly believe she hadn't followed the geography of that car trip more closely, but now she thought about it, they must have been closer to the coast than her mind placed her.
Is that the...
She stopped trying and doubled over, hands on her knees where she stood. Brandon was gently panting at last from the hike. Yes, that is, my friend. Katie's knees buckled, and she let herself drop ungracefully to the leafy floor in a heap. Brandon joined her, favouring the cross-legged sitting option, observing as she tried to recuperate. Haha, you don't take well to this, Kay, do you? He laughed, slapping her lightly on the knee as she lay on her back, gathering enough breath to talk.
I'm going to need a little rest before we continue. Please?
Brandon smirked. That's okay. It's downhill all the way after this anyway. He crawled over to her on all fours and magically picked her up into a sitting position between his knees, before leaning against a tree trunk that he'd already scoped out. Katie finally calmed her heartbeat and breathing down, and just sat once again, engulfed by Brandon's arms. Not in a cold, wet field at night, but in front of a panorama of treetops, lit by late afternoon fading sunlight and the not-so-distant sea rolling away. She heard kittiwakes and gulls, and the fresh sea air tinged her taste buds as she inhaled the scent of salt water and seaweed drifting in on the breeze.
We'll stay a little longer,
she said, not content to lose her breath again so early, despite the comparatively easy walk down to the beach, which she figured was the most obvious destination after this.
This is gorgeous, she mused. Right here, right now, this is.
She cozied up deeper into his embrace, behind her back, and felt his warm breath behind her.
Am I allowed to kiss you?
She said coyly, remembering her shock encounter down the hill.
What's the deal with asking?
He said.
You might be in charge of when we do anything.
She bumbled, feeling stupid. No. We've laid you enough ground rules already.
Yeah, but is it imposing?
She whispered, her eyes eager.
Kay, you were the least imposing thing ever.
No, it's not crossing a line, he soothed. She twisted her neck to the side as much as she could, and he glanced at her deer-like eyelashes flicking for a second before he sank into her. Their shoulders rotated some, and Katie once again found herself in that heart-fluttering relaxation again. Before today, she had never been kissed. Sheltered. Chapter 23. Beach Babes. As they neared the beach, the ground under the mottled woods turned to sand, and thick dune grasses began to poke up on either side of them. Katie insisted on walking side by side with Brandon, like a couple, and held out her little finger as a lure for Brandon to hold hands. It worked. They wandered over to the shore, and Brandon sat down while Katie paddled.
"Who's the wimp now?"
she said, playfully bouncing on her ankles in the water. "Oh, it's still you," he mocked.
"I've always liked paddling in the water. People look at me and say it's childish, that I should grow up and stop playing around."
"Maybe people are too serious, and just trying to hide the fact that they're too embarrassed to go in themselves."
"Yeah, I like that explanation," she grinned. "Did you ever do stuff like this when you were a kid?"
she asked curiously. "Rock pooling mainly. Also swimming out as far as we could go, which probably seems further when you're a kid than it actually is." She nodded thoughtfully.
"Ever thought of having kids and teaching them how to have fun without growing up too fast?"
she quizzed. A reluctant, puzzled look formed on his face. Not really. I'm not good with kids. I had a few, near misses with Kimberly, I think. She's sometimes asking the same question. It's funny how I'm careful with protection and she's not. She's too clever to be careless, so I think that's a hint.
Katie laughed, a cringeworthy notion popping into her head as her eyes lolled to the sky.
"What?" asked Brandon with a frown.
"I was gonna say, it sounds like a sperm steal,"
she said, suppressing a blush. Brandon dropped his head low and chuckled, equally flustered. God, I hope she knows better than that. It'd be a bit rapish."
She sniggered and bit her lip for a moment, gazing at him with a concerned smile.
"No consent for nicking your babies?"
he laughed. Yeah. But no, she knows better than that."
Katie held his gaze, doubtfully.
"Even while you've been fighting?"
she said. Brandon went all diplomatic. "We're not fighting. We're just..." he sighed. "Having differences of opinion on how we live. And it's all bumps in the road which can, and will, be smoothed out," he said, finally nodding to himself with a pleased expression. Katie's lip twisted. She splash-strided out of the lapping waves to sit beside him, hiding half her face behind her knee as she gazed at him inquisitively.
"You love her, don't you?"
she said, more of a statement than a question. "Yes," he said.
"And I love you,"
she claimed limply, pressing her lips to her knee with a frown. He glanced over at her with an honest look. "If I wasn't already with her, then maybe we could have dragged this out longer, gal." She peeked back at him out of the corner of her eye, but looked forward again, distracted by her thoughts. After a stroll to the far side of the beach, Katie and Brandon found a large, scattered crest of large rocks and nestled amongst them. She could see at even the first approach there were captured pockets of water in each of the topmost rock gaps. Rock pools. As the sun vanished behind the forest, they spent the hours of draining twilight catching shiny fish, and Brandon dug small makeshift rivers for them to swim to the waves, much to Katie's delight. Then after she collected shells in her small backpack, they climbed up the steep sand to the high dunes, which felt like easy walking as each footstep sunk them upright into the sand. Brandon reached the top first, and dug a small step into the loose sand lower down to sit in, using the dune peak itself to lean on. Katie did the same, a meter or so across from him, being sure not to sit further away than an arm's reach. When she settled, she looked out over the sea and saw the lights of a coastal town on the far shore to the northeast. They were quiet then, and Brandon leaned back to look upward. She traced his eyes and saw the stars beginning to blaze through the dusty brown-blue skies. And then he talked, almost to himself. I don't believe in God, you know. I've always trusted in nature's ability to just be. Be what it is, and form by itself. Those little fish down there we helped escape, we once looked like that. Little differences. Armor plating and segments, perhaps, but not far off. And then time spun for longer than we can imagine, and they became us. And now, we're up there, he said, raising a hand up to a point at a glistening dot above them. It looked like a star, but it was slightly brighter than the background stars, and it moved. Not at speed, like the wisp of a shooting star or a meteor, but gradually.
What's that? She whispered.
The ISS, he said. International Space Station. It's meant to take a pass this evening above us. That means it must be around 7 o'clock. She glanced at her mini oval wristwatch.
You're right, she said, confirming.
Pretty beautiful that we can go from pond slush to fish, squiggly line, to that, he said, smiling and marvelling. That's nature. People say man-made technology isn't nature, but it is. All of it. All of us. A car isn't that different from a snail shell. It's created from the organism. It has a complex form. It shelters us. He looked up again. Science and nature is fine by me. I don't need a god to explain how we got all this. And life's too disappointingly random for there to ever have been a supernatural conscious force adjusting everything. If God made everything, who made God? He finished. She smiled at his sudden ramble into the air, and how patient she was to absorb it all.
I don't really believe either, but people will say, you know, God was always there.
He nodded. Yes, but if he could just always be there without being crafted by someone, then why can't we? She gazed upwards at the heavens, and remembered how everyone called the stars the heavens, and how it always struck as a pretty name, despite being debunked and demoted to just another neighbourhood outside ours. Brandon patted his stomach like a drum kit for a second. Yeah, God is a human construct. Nobody can believe all this majesty without assuming there was a bloke painting it all. Nobody except the intelligent ones who try to find out what something is by actually looking at it, playing with it, seeing it move, understanding it. Katie half closed her eyes as she rested in the sand. The rhythmic sloshing of the waves ahead calmed her. When she opened them again, she was aware of little clicks and black blurs flying in groups of two in coordinated aerial displays across her vision. Pipistrelle bats.
Does that make us better than religious people then?
She replied into the dimming air. No, Brandon shot back automatically. It makes them wrong in their assumptions, but they're still people. A lot of them have morals and wouldn't hesitate to help you out. Some want to rip out your guts for disbelieving. Some just smile and nod, as I probably do to their theories. They're just people.
But they're wrong, though?
She asked, calmly. Yes.
But we can't say that they're wrong, because we can't prove it.
No, we can't. That's true. They wrote a story about an invisible man who's actually a force that made everything and is undetectable. It's a dirty trick. Brandon pursed his lips. Guess you're heading for agnosticism, then?
I don't know. Maybe.
She smiled, shivering.
It's getting cold, science boy.
Sheltered. Chapter 24. Nest of Nature. Brandon agreed to take her back to the tent. It was a long walk through the freakish nighttime woods, and without Brandon,
The forest would have scared Katie in its near pitch blackness. But as Brandon put it, you can see with your ears. And she heard the creak on the mostly downhill journey. The sound of the water gave her some geography, and instead of crossing the water lower down on the precarious stepping stones, they found a fallen tree further upstream was just a treat for getting them across without incident. When they reached the tent, it was 7:45, and the gloomy black chill of the forest had chilled her narrow knees to the consistency of a brittle ice sculpture, or so she believed. The tent was a warm relief. On first touch, the thick blankets lined up inside the small space were cold, but after she got her boots off and threw them outside, she realized it was much more homely than hard sand for reclining on. Her bare feet padded around the back of the cold quilt as Brandon kneeled in and switched on a torch tied hanging from the ceiling hoop. "Lovely. Now let's hope age doesn't snore," he said, swinging around to undo his hiking boots before swinging his feet in next to hers.
"Let's hope he is actually asleep,"
she smirked, gazing up at Brandon's lower back as he sat higher and started doing up the doors and flysheet. Almost straight afterward, he reorganized his floor space and unrolled their sleeping bags over the top. He started to unzip the sleeping bag, but the zip got caught.
"Damn it,"
he said irritatedly. "Can never trust these things." Behind him, Katie started getting out of her clothes. She took her skirt off, and her jacket, and then was about to take off her long sleeve when Brandon looked over his shoulder toward the rustling. "What are you doing?" he questioned, a puzzled smile on his face.
Getting undressed? For bed?"
he laughed. "You haven't been camping in a long time, have you?"
"What?"
she squeaked in confusion. "It's the beginning of the frickin' winter, and hey, even in summer you're gonna probably freeze up at night. It's not like we're in a house." Baffled, she put her right arm back through her sleeve.
"Oh,"
she said, perplexed.
"Well, what about body heat?"
He gave the broken zip a glance and dismissed it, rolling over onto his side to smirk at her. "Well, yeah, that'll do a little to warm you up. But seriously, you're gonna want to keep everything on," he explained, although a devious smile passed across his face for a second.
You're right. I haven't been camping in a long time,"
she said, reaching out blankly to find her jeans from her bag. "Of course we could do both," he suggested smoothly, laying still with his eyes watching her expressions more intently for signs. She pulled slowly away from her bag and stared at him.
"Fully clothed hugging in a single sleeping bag sort of thing?"
she asked. "Well, sure," he replied. "Later." Her heart seemed to drop a beat as she sat staring at him under the torchlight. They stayed still for a minute, not moving, but observing each other's various disbelieving expressions and silently daring each other to make the first move. The first move was hardly noticeable when it happened. Brandon patted her bare knee, as he had so many times before, gently and firmly, then continued staring at her. Playfully, she patted his thigh, then popped back into her almost cross-legged sitting position. He touched her knee again. She placed a hand on his waist and rubbed it lightly. His hand reached out to her knee as she did so, but remained there, stroking around it. She kept stroking at his waist, but pulled herself up to lean on him, like a sleepy lioness. Her new position afforded him easier access to stroke her calves, and then to bring his hand to rest on her inner thigh, where it ceased to move.
"Where do you want to go with this?"
she asked, trembling a little as she blinkingly looked at his hand. He got up quickly and kneeled at the other side of the small tent, away from her, and she suddenly felt a pang of regret and fear eat at her.
"No, what? What did I do?"
she said hastily. "You asked me a question," he said, Where do you want to go with this, you said, he explained casually. He took off his dark hoodie and stretched the t-shirt underneath off him too. Well, I'm going to go here, he chirped instructionally, falling closer beside her in the center of the tent on his back, before half sitting up and undoing his jeans to leave them loosely hanging a few inches under his boxers. And come here, he motioned cutely with his index finger. She smiled and edged closer on her knees. You're going to sit astride me, he commanded. She held an edge of her falling fringe back as she looked down at the contours of his smooth stomach under the pendulum torchlight, raising one leg across him and sitting against his warm skin. Feeling comfy up there? He said, bouncing his stomach up and down a couple times to see if she'd fall off. She giggled and pressed her palms against his chest for support. When he stopped moving, he looked at her pointedly. Instead of just using his chest as a support foundation, her hands lifted and smoothed their way around his front, like tracing the curves of mountains and rivers. She pursed her lips.
It's like terrain.
He rolled his eyes ever so slightly, and she put her hands to her face, giggling.
I'm sorry, that sounded so geeky.
Nah, it's all right, he said, gripping her wrists and pulling them away from her blushing cheeks. He found the edges of the bottom of her stripy long-sleeved t-shirt and pulled it slowly up, over her, with one hand, smoothing the curve of her waist, up her left arm, and all the way to her fingertips as she stretched vertically to get the shirt off. He kissed her, briefly, before she brought her arms back down. She undid her cream-coloured bra briskly and hid her chest with a forearm as she threw it aside. She lay forward onto his chest before letting go and then kissed his collarbone.
They aren't very good, she said.
Are you forgetting I've already seen them? He laughed, stroking down the curve of her back as she lay flumped forward against him, feeling his warm skin across her front.
Yeah, a little glimpse. I don't know what I was thinking there. I just needed you to see me. I thought it would somehow make you indebted to me. Stupid idea, she rambled.
Get up, let me see you, he murmured softly to her. She slowly obeyed and rose up again, exposing her small round breasts in his vision. She didn't really know what to do then, except look at him as he observed her. But it was a nice feeling, being observed. He seemed to enjoy how she looked, and not reject it as ugly or too skinny. She nearly giggled with a mild embarrassment. She'd never been touched like that before by anyone but herself, hands following soft contours and appreciating curves. She liked his firm grip around her waist, and once again brushed her hands across him, smiling as her short hair got in the way. As she sat perched on his stomach, his hands let go, and with a ruffling sound behind her, she heard him strip his jeans down lower and pull his boxers out of the way. Lean forward again, he persuaded, and when she did so, he pulled her legs in close together and leaned forward to pull off her white panties. She didn't resist. She just curled up against his chest as she folded her knees to discard her knickers. For a moment, she lay snuggled up to him, hemmed in close to him, but he clasped some firm hands around her upper arms. Hey, scaredy cat, what you afraid of? He said, raising her up to a sitting position again. He reached down and stroked at her inner thigh, like he had before, only this time there was no hindrance for him to move closer, encircling her clit gently. Now, I want you to reach down behind you until you find my cock, he guided. Her eyes widened at the sudden use of the word. It sounded coarse, pornographic. But why would Brandon James ever be subtle in this position? She felt it in her hands, a warm muscular protrusion, rigid and springy whenever she moved it too far away in her hand. She gripped both her hands around it behind her back, and Brandon put a hand under both her knees to strongly tease her thighs astride him. She felt she knew what to do, a natural instinct, and a desire to consume him whole within her. She slid down slowly onto him. It hurt a little when she went too fast, although her hymen had already been broken when she was young, so the pain was only through getting used to feeling his extent stretching inside her. But when it was in, she moved it gently out for a few more strokes, before taking it in and pausing. Brandon shoved some extra pillows behind his back, so that he was more sat up than lying down, then asked another favour. "Wrap your legs around my back," he said, still with that commandingly smooth tone, his rich, deep voice a mixture of warmth and authority that she could do nothing but admire. He had a sweet voice, she had to admit, and preferred hearing a well-spoken boy's voice to any of the numerous squeaky-voiced girl voices she'd had to put up with in the last few months. She couldn't stop herself at that moment from helping herself to his lips. They were rounded and soft, and softer still the more she moved hers across them. And then, with small licks at first, she felt his mouth open into hers, and she pressed closer to him, with intricate movements swinging the position of her head round from right to left. When she broke off the engulfing kiss a moment later, she felt her hips roll free, wishing to move. He rocked her to the side to get her going, and she leaned her cheek against his, her hands propping her on his ribs, rasping for a breath she didn't know she needed. It felt good to slide her hips back and forth along him, she felt, and she inhaled a gentle, wispy breath as she smiled behind her closed eyes. That roll of her hips then became a bounce, as Brandon placed a straight palm on her tummy and nudged her back upright to sit tall on him. She was light, and he somehow had control over her bounce from under his own hips, rocking her up and down in fluid motions to ride him. Eventually, she discovered her own control and tried to join in, settling on a rhythm that extended the apex of her leaps up to his tip, then falling down to his base, letting his shaft ride up deep into her before the next controlled bounce. They sat there in the tent, entwined with one another, like a pair of animals moving with each other in a harmonious brawl, oscillating and colliding in pulsing movements, both feeling this tremendous surge of sexual feeling, connected loosely together, enjoying being lost in their oblivious pleasures, but still aware of each other's part in their own intense sensations. Katie's messed up hair had been in her way for a while now, and she felt it sway across her eyes. She moaned an involuntary cry as Brandon delivered her another surge of energy, the one that took her further into climax than she could go any more, and she collapsed to fall back onto him, feeling a light field of sweat on her front as she once again pressed her torso onto his. Her loss of control rallied him on to passionately lose his own last burn of energy, and as he kept going as she lay against him, and the tingling remaining as he at last came to orgasm himself, his stomach muscles buckling tight under her as his hips tightened and cock hardened deep inside of her, contracting like fading heartbeats as the spasms tapered off. He dropped his hands to his face in relieved ecstasy as the last of what he had to give ebbed out. In an exhausted bundle they lay together, and he felt Katie's small weight pressing down softly on his body from above as she lay atop him, on the edge of sleep. As awkwardly as it had begun, he could never have known that physical encounter could go so smoothly. Before a beginner, perhaps even a virgin, she had picked up the ropes more formidably than he ever expected. This wasn't clumsy sex, although he knew he could have accepted the cuteness of a clumsy approach. This had been coordinated, beautiful even. He wondered if it had been that way because of how much control he had, and, following sheepishly, how loyal she had been in following his lead. Or perhaps she knew something about his rhythms. Either way, he admired her for taking him to such a blissful end. and he respected her all the more for her possibly accidental ability. It was different from Kim. Not as equal in roles, perhaps. Kimberly had had a lot of power to take control in the bedroom. But as he peered down under his chin and saw her peaceful smile and closed eyes against him, he felt himself unwittingly intrigued by her. His thoughts of using her as long as she blindly followed him still lay at the back of his mind, but they dwindled in the face of this new connection. He lay back, and his mind spun to Kimberly in that far-off country, shrugging off the winter with C. Was she thinking about him and how they'd fix things when she got back? Or would this reprieve merely give her a chance to decide that the rocky track they'd gotten onto was an omen of the future? He hoped not.